So next, we're going to jump into the COVID update, and I'm going to ask Kip to lead that effort.
Thank you, Dave. Good afternoon, Mayor and City Council and members of the public. I'm Kip Harkness, Deputy City Manager, and along with Lee Wilcox, serve as the Director of the Emergency Operations Center, or our EOC. So today, we're going to provide a brief update on activities undertaken in April by the City's Emergency Operations Center, an update on vaccination support efforts, supporting our county's leadership, and information on our approach to reopening of city facilities and the resumption of more in-person office work. So at a top level, globally, the pandemic continues to rage with almost 700,000 new cases and some 11,000 dying each day, with both of these numbers likely to be significant undercounts, especially with many in rural areas in particular, lacking access to tests, medical treatment, and often dying without being counted as part of this death toll. Access to vaccines continues to remain very limited in most countries in the world. Here in the United States, we appear to be nearing a positive tipping point with vaccinations increasing and cases declining overall, and with the outbreaks we saw in the upper Midwest appearing to subside. Here locally in Santa Clara County, some 2,068 people have died from COVID-19. We have 76 patients currently struggling with the disease in local hospitals, and the 7-day rolling average of new cases has declined to about 98. We remain in the orange tier overall. Our work in the Emergency Operations Center is guided by the city's roadmap shown here, which highlights in pink the 18 most important initiatives that we are undertaking in response to the pandemic. This slide provides a snapshot of the work of the EOC for the month of April 2021. Our numerous branches continue to do work in support of our most vulnerable communities. You've already heard a bit about our volunteers and their partners during the Unsung Heroes, and you will receive a vaccination task force update shortly. Additionally, you will receive extensive information from many of our branches during the study session later this evening. So I will highlight the one branch, Beautify SJ, which we will not be covering in depth elsewhere. Our Beautify team worked tirelessly to bring biweekly trash services to over 100 encampments, resulting in over 600 trash pickups, and just from our most complex sites alone, some 420 tons of trash were removed. More tonnage was picked up from the other sites, but those are not tracked by tonnage. At the same time, the team supported 8 interagency cleanups, which gives us access to property owned by other agencies or jurisdictions and to assist them in cleaning up their property. We also deployed our rapid team to remove some 247 tons of illegally dumped trash and debris. I'm grateful to all of the people and the teams in the Emergency Operations Center for their unrelenting work in service of those who have borne the burden of this pandemic. Now we're going to take a deep dive into the work of the Vaccine Task Force, which was created in December to support the county's vaccination efforts. For this section, I will turn it over to Ann Tran, who is the director of our Vaccination Task Force, to share the work of the team and what is coming next. Ann, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you, Kip. Good afternoon, Mayor, Council members, and members of the public. My name is Anne, and I lead our city's vaccination task force here in the EOC. I'm really excited to provide you with an update on our vaccination efforts. Back in January, I introduced our initial roadmap, which our goal was to ensure that at least 85% of San Jose residents are vaccinated by August 1st. And our objectives were to connect our community to vaccinations, advocate for equity, speed, and scale, and connect our employees to vaccinations. Next slide. Since then, we've made quite a bit of progress on this front. And even in the face of vaccine supply shortage for February and March, we've prioritized outreach to seniors 65 and older, and have since expanded to other vulnerable populations such as the unhoused, those with disabilities, and even residents in highly impacted census tracts who are among the least vaccinated. We've advocated alongside our county and our partners to call upon the state and the federal government to ensure that equitable vaccine distribution means that more vaccine would be allocated to communities who are most at risk, most vulnerable, and who are first to be impacted by COVID-19 wouldn't be the last to receive the vaccine. And we ask that the state prioritize vaccinations based on census tract data, not just zip codes. And in addition to accounting for population size, but the state also considers the social vulnerability index and COVID-19 impact rates in its prioritization efforts. We've also worked to connect our employees to vaccinations by way of the first responder clinic, and all while trying to find ways to expand community vaccination sites in the city of San Jose, while helping our partners and our county with outreach. Next slide. Within 3 months, the team has completed our first roadmap. Next slide. Now our main focus is to expand upon ways in which we can further connect our community to vaccinations so that we can reach that goal of 85% of San Jose residents vaccinated by August. Next slide. Keeping that focus on our most vulnerable, we must build vaccination capacity through equity, speed, and scale, as well as maximize education, engagement, and information dissemination so that we can expand access, confidence, and acceptance of vaccines to our community. Next slide. Our new roadmap will focus on vaccination operations, such as building capacity to put on more vaccine events in communities, as well as prioritize hiring more staff to support our county, who is lead in this overall COVID-19 response effort, and as well as support our partners and providers to augment the county's mobile vaccination efforts and continue our outreach efforts and provide injector support through the fire department where there is need. Next slide. We have a two-pronged approach to building capacity for community vaccinations. We want to build more partnerships with and collaborate with healthcare partners to bring even more vaccination events to hardest hit communities for our most vulnerable residents. Just within the last month, we've been able to collaborate with healthcare partners in a number of different ways. On April 10th, we collaborated with the San Andreas Regional Center, Silicon Valley Independent Living Center, Parents Helping Parents, and Healthier Kids Foundation to put on our first vaccination event with Safeway at the San Andreas Regional Center to administer 300 doses of vaccine to our residents with disabilities. We then tried to partner with AUCI to put on a vaccination event using our Rotunda facility on April 16th. And in partnership with AUCI and Silicon Valley Independent Living Center, we were able to administer 540 doses of vaccine to those who are unhoused, unstably housed, and those with disabilities. And the most exciting thing about this event is that we were also able to provide hot meals, 500 meals, and help our residents sign up for their stimulus checks. And 20 of the injectors that supported the event that day, 8 of them were from our San Jose Fire Department. And then we tried to meet the communities right in their backyards. On April 18th, we partnered with Project Access and Safeway to put on a vaccination event at Foxdale Village Apartments. And we were able to administer 366 doses for this event and provide 300 meals. This is the only event in which we've maxed out all of our vaccine supply for that day. All events are accompanied with neighborhood flyering, targeted communications, and other outreach efforts. When we look at supporting the county, we want to provide our staff to support with county vaccination operations. Our San Jose Fire Department have supported the county with vaccine administration through the first responders clinic since January. This clinic has since transitioned to a public vaccination site last month. Currently, our fire department is also supporting with in-home vaccinations for very frail, vulnerable residents who can't easily leave their homes. As the county is scaling mobile vaccinations in neighborhoods, our city is supporting in targeted outreach and canvassing, as well as broad communications such as social media engagement and next door, in which we have a larger presence than the county. Our fire department is also prepared to staff and support county mobile vaccination sites to add capacity where there is need. We are also supporting the county with scaling staffing capacity through hiring 200 multilingual employees, also known as vaccine champions, to support non-clinical operations at vaccination sites. So it takes about 15 city staff. The majority are from HR, OER, the library, public works, and environmental services department to make this hiring and logistics team able to support this recruitment. To date, we've received over 1,000 applications and 300 of those applications are in the queue for screening and bilingual testing. We've reached our commitment of 80% bilingual staff to the county. And as of Monday, we've sent 50 vaccine champions to the county to support operations, and we'll send more in batches in the coming weeks. Next slide. I want to say a special thank you to our San Jose fire departments. Since January, 47 firefighters have supported the county's first responder clinic, and some are now deployed to support mobile vaccinations. 2,170 city employees were able to get vaccinated through this first responder clinic. Now the fire department is also carrying out in-home vaccinations. The county received 1,224 requests for in-home vaccinations. Of those, 905 residents met the federal Medicare definition for in-home or homebound, and that means 575 individuals have gotten vaccinated through this program to date. The current capacity for this program is 200 vaccinations per week, and this is being supported by different fire departments, including our own San Jose Fire Department. Another five firefighters will support this Saturday with Bay Area Community Health on May 8th to deliver vaccinations to residents in the Cadillac and Winchester neighborhoods at Rosemary Elementary School. And then another eight will support Aki at the Rotunda once more for the second dose event that is happening on May 14th. Next slide. So the new challenge is access and acceptance, not supply. The county receives additional vaccines from the Health Resources and Services Administration, also known as HRSA, which is a federal program. Last week, the county received over 200,000 doses from HRSA. And this week, the county also received 62,880 Pfizer and Moderna doses from the state, with current capacity to administer 250,000 doses per week. The county is currently providing about 30,000 vaccinations a day, and the state is projected to receive about 1.7 million vaccines, including Johnson & Johnson doses. In other words, this means supply is exceeding vaccinations per day, and vaccinations per day are decreasing for the first time since they began, just starting a week after eligibility expanded to all residents 16 and older. About 70% of the county's population age 16 and older have gotten at least one vaccine dose. For the city of San Jose, the number of first dose vaccinations for those 16 and over is 72%. A total of 43% of the county's population age 16 and older have completed their vaccination. So that means either two full doses of Pfizer or Moderna vaccine or one Johnson & Johnson dose. The remaining 30% of the county's residents who are unvaccinated are disproportionately Latinx, low-income, young, and among San Jose residents are concentrated in the east side and near downtown. Due to differences in data collection regarding ethnicity, the number of vaccinated Hispanic residents was previously underreported by an estimate of 22,000 residents. Even with that correction, the Latinx vaccination rates are still at 46%, still the lowest compared to other demographics in our county. Next slide. So, in order to reach the remaining unvaccinated residents, a targeted and strategic approach is required to break down existing barriers. Our overall strategy for vaccine messages is to increase early in May, assuming that's when the supply of doses would catch up with the demand for them. However, this timeline ended up being pushed up when the county received additional doses of vaccine in mid-April, and the city has resumed its phone bank and continued targeted flyer drop efforts to meet that demand, as well as push traffic to vaccination sites via targeted social posts and emails. And we've also leveraged local media in driving traffic to vaccine locations co-hosted by the city. A number of efforts are starting next week, including the next batch of direct mailer to targeted zip codes, geofenced digital ads to targeted zip codes, print and radio ads, and a whole social media influencer campaign. Materials are being produced in languages most spoken in target census tracts, primarily Spanish, English, and Vietnamese. Influencer partners are primarily Latinx, Vietnamese, Filipino, and Black community members who were not previously connected to city communication channels. Our emphasis has been on digital content and direct mail because of the quick and cost-effective nature of reaching our target audiences. We are looking forward to sharing more information with the Council regarding each of these various tactics at our next update. However, in the next month, we will continue to support the county with and our healthcare providers with neighborhood canvassing efforts in San Jose's 46 priority census tracts, as well as continue working with our healthcare providers in the county to put on more evening and weekend events to accommodate for working hours and schedules. And then we will also bolster our partnerships with CBOs and outreach and engagement to small businesses, faith-based organizations to ensure that we promote vaccination acceptance and confidence in our communities. Lastly, we will also try to find ways to do more engagement in communications to our young adult population, as those between ages 18 and 29 make up the highest number of unvaccinated individuals in the county. Yet, although cases are flattening, individuals 18 to 34 account for the highest number of infection rates across any age group. Next slide. I want to talk a little bit about place-based vaccinations for our most vulnerable residents. There are about 46 census tracts with a score of 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10 in the city. These areas are shown as red on the map. We call these census tracts priority impact areas, and they may change over time, but because of the map highlights based on percentiles, we will always see the 20% of tracts with the highest need in terms of low vaccination rates, high COVID-19 positivity, coupled with social vulnerability and healthy places index on this map. The priority impact areas are concentrated in the following locations. On the east side, in District 5, neighborhoods just east and south of downtown in District 3, Seven Trees in Edenvale in District 2 and 7 respectively, and more isolated areas in Alviso in District 4, Buena Vista and Burbank area in District 6, and the Cadillac and Winchester neighborhoods in District 1. The purple icons indicate vaccination sites in which we were able to partner with healthcare providers to put on more vaccination events in communities. These sites are within the high priority areas identified on the map. We've also touched over 13,800 homes through our various flyering and canvassing efforts. In District 3, we've reached Alma, Luna, Horace Mann, 13th Street, Julian Street, and St. James and Oakland Road in our canvassing efforts. For District 5, it was the Hillview, Cassell, and Foxdale Apartments area. In District 6, it was the Winchester, Sherman Oaks, and Buena Vista area. In District 7, the Tropicana, Little Orchard, and Summerside. We've also canvassed Overfelt and Meadow Fair around Tully and Eastridge for District 8, and then in District 9 and 10, Brantham, Southside, and the Marshall Cottle areas and the apartments around that area. So since the county was facing severe vaccine shortages in March, we couldn't make phone calls or book appointments through our phone bank for fear of adding more distrust and confusion to our community, as we would have been driving demand for vaccine where there isn't enough supply to meet the need. However, as the vaccine situation is looking a lot better, we reinstated the phone bank on April 19th. To date, the team has made in total 6,249 calls. Our strategy moving forward is to couple canvassing and phone banking using political data to track our impact and to drive people to place-based vaccination events, as well as ensure that we saturate outreach within a 1 to 2 mile radius of any vaccination event in that area. We are working to build capacity to scale staffing for canvassing and phone banking, as well as build efficiencies in the phone bank through procurement of predictive calling technology. To date, 8 of our have been trained to access and secure registration appointments through the city's health link system or the county's health link system. However, since most of the vaccination events are walk-ups, drop-ins, and no appointments necessary, we are working to reprioritize the phone bank to help people arrange for lifts or VTA or paratransit rides to help them get to vaccination sites. Next slide. We've participated in discussions with the Latinx community around increasing vaccination rates. Every Monday night, the city and the county joins other Latinx community stakeholders to discuss how we can better support the community, especially in recovery and COVID-19 support. Together, the community stakeholders put forth suggestions for how the city and the county are able to help help increase vaccinations in the Latinx community. In order to improve access and vaccine acceptance in our Latinx community, we must build trust and focus efforts locally and geographically and engage faith-based organizations. We must also expand Spanish language access to build CBO capacity, as well as increase the number of promotoras and other outreach workers who are going out there to educate and engage with our residents. In addition to building more partnerships with CBOs, we must also increase site access by advocating for more supply to be diverted to the east side, as well as increase flexibility to expand site access for evening and weekend events to accommodate for working hours, as well as make the events more accessible by having paper and pen and paper registration, getting rid of those digital online registrations. And lastly, these recommendations that our Latinx stakeholders put forth, we're trying to find a path forward with the county to implement these strategies. Next slide. As mentioned before, supply is no longer an issue here in our county, and we must shift our focus to access and acceptance of vaccines. To date, we've completed 5 vaccination events through our partnerships, and I'm really proud to say that this afternoon, our very first city and county partnership for an evening vaccination clinic is happening at Children of the Rainbow Park. Our teams have jointly canvassed the areas leading up to today, and we are excited to collaborate to make vaccinations more accessible to our most vulnerable communities. This clinic will run from 1 p.m. to 7 p.m. tonight, and we will also have more vaccination events scheduled for the month of May with our partners, including second dose events. Next slide. Looking ahead, we're also exploring ways to make our city parks and facilities available to expand community access to vaccinations, working with the county to operate in more neighborhoods that continue to have high COVID-19 positivity rates and low vaccination rates. This effort will also help us with getting more lead time to bolster outreach and education in our communities. Next slide. And going beyond just vaccinations, our partnerships has helped us provide meals, outreach support, vaccination registration, sourcing volunteers, providing transportation, helping people sign up for stimulus checks, case management, toiletry bags, and even financial support. And this is all in an effort of getting our residents vaccinated and connected to services. And together we pave a better way towards recovery out of this pandemic through continuity of care. Next slide. Lastly, our external partners are just as important as the internal team that keeps vaccination efforts going every single day. The city, every department in the city has supported vaccination efforts in one way or another. And I am truly grateful and I feel very, very lucky to be part of this team and to be able to work with such kind, compassionate, patient, and intelligent people whose efforts have collectively made it possible for a municipality with no healthcare services as a core service, be able to find a place and space to become a prominent stakeholder and provider in delivering vaccinations to communities that need it the most, all while building partnerships that will outlast this pandemic and lead us to a speedy recovery. So to our mighty team, thank you so much for letting me speak about your accomplishments and your efforts to get us here this far. And with that, I'll hand it over to Kelly Parmley.
Wow. Thanks, Anne. You say that all with a very composed and moderate face, and that's so much to share. I have an appreciation for in a small way for all that you and your team have been doing by leading the 15-person or so group of folks here who are hiring the vaccine champions to send to the county. So seeing all of that and hearing all of that all at one time was a lot to take in. And so grateful to you and the team and the county and so many other partners, because this work, in addition to everything else that's going on in our city and in our county, it's what allows us to have this conversation and open this conversation with the council and with the community today. So Mayor, Council, members of the community, thank you. I'm Kelly Parmley, the Assistant Director for Human Resources as part of my day job, and then also have been running the Powered by People team, supporting team who's hiring the vaccine champions, and also a few other things. So I know this conversation is one that's of great importance to all of us. And I think Dave in a conversation the other day reminded us that while we might all be exhausted and tired over these last few months, we really should be excited about the prospect of being open, being able to open our city hall and our city facilities and finish some important work that we've already started in terms of opening city services. So sometimes it's a little hard to get the excitement going, but I do want to offer some promise today about where we're going and what we're proposing in terms of what we're calling return to on-site work and reopening of city facilities. In order to do that, though, I do want to take you back in time a little bit and cover some territory, some reminders that we had to do ourselves internally about where we were at the last time I spoke with you. Back in October was the third presentation that I had given about the work that we were doing to expand and reopen city services. So in October, we were in this particular stage, the orange tier, which felt like for about a hot second that we were, you know, in this stage, and then very quickly went all the way back. By December, we were in stage five. Again, it was disheartening for many of us, but we also knew how important it was for our community and for ourselves and for the safety and health of everyone to make sure that we could undo everything that we had done, not in terms of essential services, but certainly some of the things that were on the horizon. At that point in time, we were coming to you with some data, which I want to first remind you on the next slide that this was the framework under which we talked to you about some data about the status of city services, and that far left box there is the safe workplace. And that team made up of facilities and safety were the ones who've been sort of guiding and enabling and supporting the process for expanding and reopening city services. And so we came to you in October on the next slide with a picture of city services that we had never done before. And just to reorient you to this, on the far left side are services that we had gauged had been open since the beginning and continued. Those important things like water, like our streets, like our sewers, everything that needed to be maintained from an essential city service perspective. And then essentially, we also shared with you in this particular slide that we still had a large number of vacancies and we're operating a pretty large EOC at that point in time. And so the two I want to focus on the next slide are that we had gotten to this bucket of what was continuing to need support in terms of expansion. Now that we were all excited, we were in the orange tier. And on the next slide, it'll show you a highlight of some of what those services looked like in terms of how the departments had gauged their status in terms of relative to pre-COVID, you know, where were we in terms of operations. So we had very few services at that point in time that were under 75%. And then we had a very small number of services on the next slide that we had still been suspended. And on the next slide, we were getting ready and through great partners working with library and PRNS in particular to figure out how to expand services. And so I just want to pause there for a second and say, you know, we were ready, we were on the cusp, we were talking about Happy Hollow Zoo and we had gotten to that place and lots of plans. These departments have never stopped throughout the pandemic to try to figure out how we were going to get back to that place where we could have fully operational services. So on the next slide, to give you a sense of our current status, I need to take a pause here and say three things. Number one, enormous gratitude to our departments who continue to meet our asks for data. And with the support of Keith Lewis and Eric Jensen, who are the masters of data and data visualization, I'm able to share a few things with you. But our departments have been really responsive. What we did here when, with respect to data was we organized it this time differently by budget program. We had kind of a weird look at it before, some sort of amalgam of how to show services. We also are showing an EOC here that's about less than 300 at this point, somewhere between 250 and 300. At the time we back in October, it was well over 300, almost 400. And our vacancies are around almost 700 at this point. And back then they were around 680 or so. And so we want to focus on is show you a little bit about where we're at with those that are in the not fully reopened, that yellow bucket on the next page. And show you that on the next slide, Again, another look at those services that are not completely operational and require and continue to require some additional support in order for us to reopen. Now, mind you, we're all still in the orange tier and looking toward the yellow tier as our guidance for how to reopen, but we're working actively at the moment on trying to figure out how within even the orange tier we can expand reopening. On the next slide, I think what's really important is we asked the departments to just give us a quick check mark about whether or not this requires bringing employees back into a city space. So you can see most of those services, in order to get fully operational, require us to think about getting employees back into a city space. And then on the next slide, we also asked them what it require us in order to get them fully operational to bring the public back into a space. So we're on this threshold at the moment, still in orange tier, still with social distancing and many of the safety protocols, of needing to think about how do we fully get these operational. And I want to give a quick shout out to our folks in PRNS, John Cicerelli, in the library with Jill Bourne, and Chu Chang and PBCE, who've been incredibly responsive to us in terms of thinking about what can we do within the orange tier to move things along in terms of planning and still do it safely. So on the next slide, I also want to share then that we're in a very, very, very small set of services that are still suspended. And if you look on the next slide, those are cashiering and family camp, and we're well aware of the situation of both of those. And Julie Cooper has been a great voice for us needing to figure out how to serve folks who are unbanked and needing cashiering services. And so with respect to services, you know, this data has been really helpful for us to figure out how to prioritize as we are in this, what I would call liminal space of the orange tier, and trying to figure out how we manage space considerations. And yet we also need to think about a second really important constituent here. Sorry, Kip, I didn't advance that one, but the next one also is our employees. And this is another really important consideration. So we have services that we have to consider, and we also have our employees to consider. And nothing happens in the city without our employees. And so back in October, I shared with you that about 60% of our employees, our full-time employees, this was based on, have been working in the field or in a city facility. And yeah, overnight we pivoted about 40% to working remote. And at that point in time had about 680 vacancies and then almost 400 people still in the EOC. And so to get some feedback and some data from our employees about where they were at, this slide essentially says from a survey we did back in October, that about 2/3 of employees who responded to the survey and were working remotely said that they were satisfied or highly satisfied with the technology, the resources, and the equipment that they needed to work effectively and to also do that safely. On the next slide, our remote employees also told us that a large proportion, more than 50%, wanted to continue to work full-time in the remote status, and another almost 40% wanted some sort of hybrid situation. And so lastly, on the last slide, for those city employees who were folks who were working in the field or in a city facility, we had asked them some feedback about safety precautions. And this is strong feedback that our safety and facilities teams were doing a really great job to make sure that people had the training, the equipment, and the appropriate direction in order to be in those places safely. And so in terms of listening to employees, I think that was important feedback as we considered and now are considering the most important thing and of interest to everyone here, which is on the next slide. What's going to guide our work going forward, and what is our proposal about how to continue to do this safely and at the same time understand that our community wants services, as all of you, to be fully operational, and how do we prioritize those things at the same time? So on the next slide, with a lot of conversation and some good framing work from Kip, who got us on a good foot here, the first two principles for us as we've started a work group that cuts across OER, HR, IT, facilities, is number one, our employee health and safety and well-being has to be at the center of what we do. And at the same time, we have to have the end in mind, which is the effective and efficient service delivery. And so how do we think about services first and at the same time balance the considerations around employee health and safety? The other thing is, the third one is so important, is that remote work is here to stay, and many workplaces will be hybrid. But with that service delivery in mind, not everybody's going to be able to work remotely. And so how, under the most flexibility and yet being responsible with both city resources and employee safety, do we think about how to use office time where office time does best and where home time might be serving us really well? And then lastly, we have to continue, and as a person who's been deeply involved with our business process automation folks and partnering with IT so much, we have to continue to work on technology and process improvements. It doesn't serve everybody the same or everybody well. We have to continue to focus on those who are not being served well in those processes, but to serve both our employees and our community, continuing to invest in technology and process improvement is going to be really important. So we hope to use those and hope that you will join us in using those five principles as we consider how to resume on-site work and reopen city facilities. On the next slide, a couple of things that I think are super important. Clearly, you heard from Anne and her team, and Kip has been really strong in helping us understand that the vaccination progress is incredibly important and is serving us really well. You know, I've been reminded of in the last week that our vaccines are really, really good. So as the general population reaches those thresholds that we're looking for, 85% for us in the city, and I think the county's target is 75%, that means that we can do things potentially if they relieve us of the social distancing and some other things, we can be more safe in space together. By June 1, we believe all of our employees who wanted to get vaccinated will be able to have been vaccinated. And so that gives us another sort of milestone. And we also know that we need to continue safety protocols. So we're waiting to see what happens with social distancing, which is our greatest constraint on space, as you all know. If you've come to City Hall and you are around elevators and reminded of shared space in the lobbies, there's and conference rooms and everything else, we are still constrained by space. Masking, however, will probably continue for some time. The other thing that's really important is I, having watched this with everybody else for over the last year, we'll follow the county's lead as we move to the yellow tier for sure. However, and we just have had three or four major conversations in the last few days around this, is how can we prioritize with the insights from the departments about the most impacted services and communities? And I've already had exchanges with PRNS, with library. They've been phenomenal planning partners. I'm able to tell us on a moment's notice what are the most impacted, and then work with us on safety, and then recently with PBCE. So we're gonna do as much as we can, as fast as we can in the orange tier while we wait for the yellow, but it's not gonna stop us from getting ready to expand and reopen. And then the other thing, which the folks on the safety team and facilities team and everybody who's involved with space considerations, as well as how we effectively deliver services, will tell you it's not an on-off switch. We've been working with the library, who've been awesome partners for months, and they will still tell you that tomorrow they can't just expand and open library branches. They're ready to do it for sure, but it takes a bit to do it. So we'll accelerate where we can, but it's just not an on and off switch. On the next slide, there are some very specific considerations to returning to City Hall. City Hall is not the only space, as most of our employees will tell you, but for sure it's one that's deeply important to all of us, both symbolically, but also in terms of service delivery for some and for the home of many employees. So we're proposing, given what we know about vaccinations, that somewhere in early July we can do a soft opening. We're going to work closely with departments to vet proposals about who they want to return and how that might look, provide some feedback, but give maximum flexibility. And we're looking forward to the public somewhere in early August, again, depending on health guidance, but again, really strong planning going on and really good conversations with the first floor and all the way up to the fourth floor in particular. And then we've already started and have been engaged in conversations around council chambers and how do we do and prepare for a hybrid environment in early August. So these other considerations in terms of returning on site, again, social distancing that I mentioned a few times really constrains our space. When that's relieved and the vaccination thresholds have been met, we are in good stead to be able to have folks in a space. Technology is so tricky and so important to what we want to do, particularly in that hybrid environment. And so we really need to be careful about not overloading facilities and IT when it comes to how do we figure out a hybrid environment. Nobody has this figured out yet. And that's going to take some time to understand what works for our employees, like what's the best technology, how do we not do something too fast. And then lastly, not unlike our counterparts in other agencies, we're working on as a work group making a recommendation for developing an overall city goal for a proportion of our workforce to work remote. Jennifer and I have had many conversations about how important we feel this is going to be to retention of employees and also attraction of the next generation, leveraging what we've learned about what works from a remote perspective. Again, honoring the fact that services have to come first and how does service delivery need to happen, and then asking considerations around what might happen remotely. So with that, Kip, that's what I have to offer up today if you want to bring us home.
Thank you, Kelly, and thank you, Anne, and most importantly, the teams that you're all working with to make all of this possible. I think you both have said it very well. I'll just close there and hand it back to Dave Sykes, our city manager, for any concluding comments, and then we are willing and able to take any questions, feedback, and comments that the council and community may have.
Yeah, thank you, Kip, and thank you, team. Really appreciate the work that went into this and all the discussions we've been having. And so I'll pass it back to the mayor and the council and look forward to their input and questions.